As usual, this talk will be at some places a little bit very, very technical, but I think most of the people know that already. I'm talking very fast, and I always have some crazy programming code to show to you. So, but this time it's about memory map directory in the first part of the talk. I will show you what memory mapping is in general and why you should use it for Lucene, Zola, or Elasticsearch, and why it is enabled by default and how to configure it. And in the second part, I will show you some new features which are coming for the first time with Java 16 and later, but are not yet included in Lucene, which make the whole thing better scaling for the future. So the first part is now about memory mapping, and before starting with that, I will have something like a short history about how you are reading from files in standard C code. So as you see here, we already have some C code, not Java code this time, and this shows how I call it always the 60 side of file reads, how you would read from a file. So basically, you open the file descriptor, and then you have to seek to some specific portion of the file, and then you can read the stuff into a buffer. And that buffer is then transferred over to the Java process, for example, and there you can do your stuff like analyzing the contents to do a search in the index or something like that. So in general, if you look at this type of call, you have two problems with that. The first is you have to allocate some buffer in your program because the data has to be transferred from disk somewhere into your local process space so you can actually work with the data. And the second problem of that is that you need to do two calls into the kernel of your operating system because the first one is you have to seek to the file position, as said before, and then you have to read the data, and the kernel then have to copy it back into that buffer that you're using and transfer it over to your program. In the meantime, what the kernel also is doing is it optionally puts the stuff into the file system cache. And this nice picture here shows basically what's happening. So the program is asking for a specific file. So it does a syscall to read some bytes from the file, and the Linux kernel says, okay, it will figure out if there's a file already available in the cache, but it doesn't say, it says, I don't have it. So it goes to the hard disk and loads maybe some bytes from offset 2048 to whatever, and copies it over to the program. And then a little bit later, the process or even another process comes again and asks for the same page. And then the same thing has to be done again. But in that case, it doesn't need to read the data from disk, but it can directly transfer it from the file system cache to the program. And a little bit later, another program is coming and wants to allocate more physical memory. And then the kernel figures out, oh, there's not enough space to keep all those small snippets of the file in the RAM. So it removes it and allows for the file allocation to work. So with Java, the whole thing gets a little bit more worse because there's another issue you might know in Java. There are byte arrays, integer arrays, and whatever. And the problem is those Java arrays are residing on the heap, and suddenly, for example, the garbage collector could come and move them to another place on the heap because it wants to clean up the heap space. And because of that, because the file read, the time while it's waiting in the kernel takes some time, it could happen that at the same time, the buffer where you wanted to copy the data in the Java array is moving in the heap. So that doesn't work. And because of that, what Java is doing is it allocates another buffer outside of the Java heap just to copy the data there. And then once the transfer is done, it will then copy it from that temporary buffer to your heap space where you can work on the byte array. In Apache Lucene, when you do searching, you can use that approach with simple FS directory. And that was the first directory implementation that was be added to Lucene. But there's another problem with the whole thing, and this is why it's much more bad for Lucene, not only the double copy, but there's also the problem we only have one file descriptor per open file in Lucene. And you remember, we have to seek, and after that, we have to read from the file. And if you have multiple threads reading from the same file descriptor, you have a problem. You have to somehow coordinate the seeks and reads, so not one thread is seeking and the other one is reading, and then you get it completely mixed up. So actually, if you do that seek and read approach, it must be synchronized. And because of that, there's also the 90s style of file reads, which is quite obvious, but in early operating systems, it was not a label. There's a positional read. In that case, the whole thing is it's standard, so the seek and the read is combined into one operation in the kernel, so there's no local file pointer somewhere in your file descriptor, so it just says read from that file at offset blah 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 into the buffer. So the pro with that is, so in Lucene, the implementation is a new IO FS directory, which is used by default on 32-bit operating systems currently. And the other good thing with that is the new IO file system directory in Lucene can also use this temporary off-heap buffer. So actually, it doesn't rely on copying everything into a byte array on the operating system, so it can directly access the chunk read outside of the Java heap, and this spares also the additional copy, and we don't need any synchronization when randomly accessing the file. But there's still another problem in Lucene. So for example, if you are doing sorts in your index, or you have a huge term dictionary and you're executing a fuzzy query, which is jumping through all the terms forward, you have the problem that it needs to read blobs from the file system from different places of the file. And sometimes it only needs one or two bytes. And the problem with that is you always need to have a buffer transferred to the heap, and every time there's a system call, which takes time, so actually reads more data than actually needed. And because of that, it's very, very bad for random access, like sorting with docu values and all that stuff. There's another problem with it, that the new IO FS directory does not work well with Windows, because the positional reads in Windows are not working at all with Java, so you can only use in reality the seek and then read approach. So internally, Java will synchronize on the whole thing, and because of that, new IO FS directory is dumb slow on Windows, so this is not really an option. But now, after showing you all of that, there come some questions into the mind. Why do we copy all the data at all? So remember, we said the data is copied by the operating system into the file system cache, and the file system cache is in memory. So why is it not possible for the Java process to directly access the file system cache? Of course, you can say, yeah, that's a problem. If multiple processes are reading the same file, a process cannot really write to memory that's somehow owned by the kernel. So there's a risk. So we have to copy it. That's one reason why some people say, so we would say we cannot copy that easily. And the other question that always comes into mind is, why the hell do we need to exactly say, hey, kernel, please read that file, or read that file, this offset, this position, and I want to have 4,000 bytes of it, and I want to do something with it. Why do I need to tell that to the kernel? Why do I need to make a system call to the kernel to do that? And there's also a solution for that. I call it the memory mapping, which is the millennium style of file reads. So it's no longer the 90s style. So now we are at the beginning of the 2000s. So already all operating systems since the last two decades are already supporting that. The idea here is that you want to prevent any copy of data between the operating system kernel and the Java process and the user space. You can also avoid all syscalls. And the whole thing is you can make ideal use of the file system cache, because you're just saying, I want to read a few bytes from that file, but the operating system kernel completely allows you to do whatever you want. But how does it work? So the code for that looks really simple. I just want to access some byte from the file, but I don't want to tell the kernel to load it for me. So how does it work? And the idea behind that is the so-called virtual address space, which is the base of all the modern operating systems. So modern means later than maybe the 90s. But in all modern CPU architectures. So basically, the idea here is that you have your physical memory, which is, you can see it here on the right side, which is on, which is really the chips on your hardware. And, but your processes in your system never access that physical memory directly. The idea here is that the process itself only sees some memory area which is completely virtual. And the funny thing is every process sees somehow an identical image of that RAM. So the beginning of that virtual memory is always at the zero pointer. So every process has more or less an identical looking memory address space, but the operating system maps those virtual addresses to physical addresses in your memory. And by that, it's also possible for the operating system to separate between processes. So your Java process cannot read from your high security Apache web server and read out the private key, for example. So this is not possible because the operating system controls where to access it. And there's also another thing is, you could also, and this is now what comes into mind with memory mapping, is you can also have some of the disk space mapped out, so some of the virtual address space mapped out to disk. And how that works generally is inside the CPU, which is here the blue box in the center, you have something like a virtual address. So a process like Java is accessing virtual address. Then the CPU has an internal cache, which is a translation look-aside buffer. And this one has something like a cache. So you can query for the address 123456. And then it says, OK, this is the memory address here in the main memory. If the CPU already knows that mapping, if the mapping is not there, then there will be a cache miss. And then the operating system kernel comes in. And the operating system kernel has a huge page table, which is just showing all those mappings between the addresses here. And if the page table contains some information, so it finds out, yes, we have a hit for that page, it will do two things. It will update the cache. So processes, if the process comes later to the same address, it will hit it. And it will also deliver the address from the main memory to our progress. There is also the second problem. So for example, if the process is accessing some memory at an address which is not available at all, in that case, you will see, but you know, it's a segmentation fault because you are trying, for example, to access a null pointer, or you are trying to access an address which is far out of your virtual address space. So in that case, you get a segmentation fault. And the third case could be that in the page table, the kernel has recorded, okay, in that case, this memory should map to a file on our disk, like a Lucene index or the swap space of your operating system. And then what it can do, it will automatically map in that address to the first physical memory. And then for the process, it looks like you are accessing the data directly as if it were in RAM, but in fact, it's coming from a disk and it's only cached. And in that case, what happens here in the page table is the secondary storage, like our disk, and the file system cache in memory is somehow glued together with the process. So the process can directly access the operating system cache using the virtual address space, it sees. The advantages of that is the kernel manages the free space and there's no program logic for that needed. So it's very easy for Lucene or a process. We just say we want to have the whole index. It could be terabytes of data. Okay, not unlimited, but something like you can easily map 1 terabyte of memory into virtual address space. And then if the Lucene index wants to get some tiny bit somewhere, it will create a page fault, and then the kernel will load that page and will make it available. So for the Lucene process, it looks like the whole process is in memory, but in fact, it's just paging in the hot addresses. So for example, the term dictionary, which is used all the time for executing queries, is always inside the page cache of the operating system. But for example, something like the stored fields, which you only read seldomly for displaying search results, are paged in by a page fault. So, and if you want to improve the performance, the only thing is that you need to do in Lucene is just add more space in your physical RAM to have more of the data from disk cached. So how that works in Lucene is Lucene has a directory abstraction, you know, the simple directory, but there's also the mmap directory, which is an index output. We don't talk about that one because when an index is written to disk, we just sequentially write the bytes to the disk. We don't care about any memory mapping or at all. But the index input is backed by our logic by mapped byte buffers. And we are mapping the whole file in chunks of 1 gigabyte. So the question is, why do we do that mapping in 1 gigabyte chunks? As I said before, we can do something like map the whole terabyte of file into the 64-bit address space, which works perfectly. 64 bits has enough space for a terabyte, but there's one problem. You remember I said it's a mapped byte buffer, and the problem with Java is that mapped byte buffers are limited to 32 bits, like Java arrays, so it's an integer. And it gets worse, you only have an signed integer in Java. So basically, the buffer can only be 2 gigabytes of size at a maximum. And unfortunately, because the signed integers are missing exactly one piece at the end of the whole thing, we have to limit the whole thing to 1 gigabyte because 2 to the power of 31 minus 1, which is the maximum address, is unfortunately a little bit smaller than 1 gigabyte. And because in our code, we want to have it simple. We need to find the correct buffer. So to do that, we don't want to divide by some completely unaligned address. So in that case, we just want to do bit shifts and bit masks. And because of that, so that looks like that here. This is a code, for example, to read a byte from a Lucene index. So actually what we are doing here is chunk size power is just the number of shifts we are doing to the right. So that basically divides by 1 gigabyte. And the other one is just the remainder of the division that goes to the mask. And you see here, we are using a bit shift and the AND, so we need something like powers of 2 for the size of our buffers. And 2 gigabyte is unfortunately, it's 1 byte smaller than 1 gigabyte, 2 gigabytes. So we have to go to the next lower one, which is 1 gigabyte. So that's the problem of Lucene. If you, as said before, and most people accept it here, I also want to show you other crazy code. So for example, if you want to read an integer from our Lucene index, the code looks like this, don't be afraid. So it could happen, for example, that one integer is exactly at the end of this 1 gigabyte buffer. And then, of course, we cannot read the full int because it's 4 bytes. And what happens there is if you try to read it from our buffer, we will get an exception. And what happens here now is that in that case, our code falls back to the standard way and reads it 1 by 1. And then we read it byte by byte. And at the end, it's also wrapped over. And then we are moving our buffers and we are going to the next buffer. So that's very, very seldomly happening. And because of that, don't be afraid. In Lucene, it's written using exception logic, because in 99% of all cases, you will never hit the boundary with an integer read when you do that. But it's only a very, very, very exceptional case. And because of that, the code is written by glad. So in most cases, we will only see execute the whole code here, and it's perfectly optimized by Java for reading. So there are some other characteristics. So Lucene also has write once, read many. It's highly concurrent. And because of that, we need duplicated byte buffers. And duplicated byte buffers means every index gets a duplicated byte buffer of the memory mapped area. And so each of them have their own pointer for seeking inside the buffer. And the other problem that we have is we have no synchronization. And now we have some huge problem in Lucene from the early days, which is has to do, you remember at the beginning, if we are now going and want to close a file in the Lucene index, what happens then? If we close the file and we unmap the buffer, suddenly it gets erased in the page table that we have seen before. And then when you access that one, for example, a thread is reading from that, we get a segmentation fault. And because of that, it's completely disallowed by the Java JVM to free any buffers on heap which are currently in use by any thread. So actually, in Java, the garbage collector will free the mappings. And here the problem starts with Lucene. There's a feature request, because the problem is we have a very, very tiny byte buffer for process running days, like an Elasticsearch index. It could happen that the garbage collector never removes the small byte buffer, but instead keeps it forever on heap, and the memory mapping will never go away. And to work around that, Lucene does some illegal tricks to forcefully unmap the byte buffer by hitting into the JVM internals. And it takes the risk of crashing the JVM. So for example, if you close your index reader or the Elasticsearch index is closing the index while, for example, another query is running, it will crash your JVM. So it looks like this window afterwards if there's something wrong. And so actually, we have lived with this workaround, but nobody is really happy to use it. Now, finally, I have some information. So how to use memory mapping. So by default, it's always enabled. Elasticsearch or OpenSearch use it by default for most files, only for files which are seldomly used. It does not use memory mapping or where it's not important to have random access like stored field. Solr adapts the Lucene factory and always uses memory map files for everything. So if you configure your system, you will see here, and that's just a warning for everybody. So if you use an index with memory mapping enabled, you will see in your top output, for example, here the heap space is 5 gigabytes. So you see something like residential memory of 7.6 gigabytes. But a lot of people are looking here at those 73 gigabytes. But this is said as virtual memory. So that means it's just virtual address space. It's not allocated. It's not anywhere in RAM. It's just virtual address space. And if you look here, the index, this is the Elasticsearch output. So you can it's approximately 71 gigabytes. So exactly the virtual address space is exactly what we have memory mapped with our Elasticsearch index into memory. So keep in mind, don't look at virtual address space, only the residential is fine. If you have a huge index, it could also, I have customers where it's here, it says 1.5 terabytes of virtual address space, and the machine still only has 64 gigabytes of RAM. So there's no problem, and it won't overload your machine. So if you want to tune the whole thing, you have to set some settings. I don't want to go to the thing here, because the problem is, as I said here, because we have this 1 gigabyte size. It's something like with file handles, you have to tell your operating system that you want to map as much as possible, get as much as possible memory mappings. And the other one is don't use Windows if you have a lot of RAM available, because unfortunately in Windows, the virtual address space is very, very limited. On Linux, it's 48 bits, but on Windows, it's dramatically limited to 43, 44 bits. So you can only have several terabytes of virtual address space. So, but now I'm coming to the interesting parts, which is Project Panama, which is the future, what we will see when we are coming to Java 16. So you have seen the problems that we face with virtual memory in Lucene. Now here are some of the solutions that are coming. So Project Panama is actually for improving and enriching the connections between the Java virtual machine and well-defined but foreign non-Java APIs, and including many interfaces commonly used by the C programmers. So actually, this looks like it's only useful for example, for calling some methods or doing the calls that I have shown at the beginning. But actually, it also has other key concepts which are replacing the byte buffer that we have seen before. One key concept is a memory segment on top of a memory address, which can be anywhere in the virtual address space. And the second thing is var handles, which are there to have direct access to several bits inside those memory segments. And the memory segment can cover any address space you see. So we can also have a memory address because, like said before, a memory segment can be over the whole of your virtual file, for example, that you have. And why does it work here in contrast to the to the good old byte buffer, which was limited to 32 bits? We have a positional API using longs. So the pointers into the memory segment are longs. And because of that, this is the favorite candidate for replacing that 1 gigabyte chunks in Lucene by something like a huge virtual memory portion with Project Panama. Unfortunately, there are some problems. There's something which is called thread confinement. I told you if some other process is unmapping the memory, the other process accessing it at the same time would segmentation fault the process. And because memory segment was written in Project Panama to also support the unmapping, so that means that you can unmap it from the directory, it works. So the thread confinement was added. So in Lucene's point of view, we open the file, memory map it, execute a query, unmap it, and then we are done. But unfortunately, we can view that with Lucene because we want to have multi-thread. In Project Panama, JDK 15, there was another update, which was useful in any case, but it didn't solve the problems. So after the state after JDK 15 was, we have a great memory segment with 64 bits instead of the byte buffer, but we can only use it from one thread. So not really useful for Lucene, but it fixes the unmapping problem and your JVM button segmentation. There was in 2016, I had several talks with people from the OpenJDK on the FOSDEM conferences. And with JDK 16, finally, we found a solution to do that. There's now a possibility of a shared memory segment, which is safely unmappable with a close API. And other threads accessing that segment at the same time would not crash your JVM, but would produce an illegal state exception. So after JDK 6, then we have no slowdown during access to a shared memory segment. But unfortunately, due to the implementation behind that, there's one thing that makes it a little bit, not really a showstopper, but it needs to be a problem, and we have to think about that. The global JVM impact is there. When we unmap and close it, the JVM will go into something called a save point mode and will stop all threads to somehow transform them into a state that they can get the illegal state exception afterwards. So it will shortly halt after all threads when we're unmapping a memory, and then it will proceed. And this may be a bottleneck for Lucene in the future. We have a first pull request on Lucene. You can look that out here, which works quite well. The code is using var handles, and it's very similar code here. All is fine. The only thing that we are doing here currently, we have now a chunk size of no longer 1 gigabyte, but 16 gigabyte. And why do we do that? That's a long story. I can't explain it here exactly. The reason for that is so-called address-based fragmentation. So where you often open and close index files, it's a bad idea to allocate something like a terabyte in virtual address space. Because if you later free it, want to reuse it for something else, like 1.1 terabyte, then it won't fit in that gap. So because of that, we are still doing it in several chunks. So that's something. So, and now with JDK 17, that was released 2 weeks ago, we have a little bit a better version of the whole thing, which is the incubation process comes nearer, so we can expect maybe with JDK 18 to use the new APIs. So memory segment is no longer auto-closable, so we have no resource scopes, so we can close all the index files with using the resource scope at the same time. And for that, this is a US pull request. You can watch it. It's currently under heavy development. It passes all the tests. It also uses direct access using var handles. And from the performance, it's very, very nice. It's very, very fast. But currently, there are some problems in the internals of the JDK. So bulk copies to Java arrays are very slow. The cause is known, and the fix is ongoing. So at the moment, you cannot really use it in Lucene because it would slow you down. But the idea here is to improve that in the future. So we have two problems with the Panama API, that currently we cannot really use it because it's an incubating API, so it's not visible in the JDK. You have to explicitly enable it with some command line flag. So if you want to use that feature, you also have to start your Elasticsearch or Solr with some extra command line flags in your JVM start line, and then you also need to run it with JDK 17. And you might see some slowdowns, but in the future, maybe with Lucene 10, we will have something like that enabled. Maybe it will also come with Java 9. We will see at which point it come. But that allows us to do something. We are also working in Lucene currently to remove a lot of those buffer copies from outside of the heap in the memory mapped area to inside the heap. By using, for example, the Vector API, which is another JDK enhancement process coming soon, which will speed up the vector search in Lucene and also a lot of stuff inside the posting list and term dictionaries, the Vector APIs. And there we can also do our algorithms directly outside of the heap. And with that in combination, we are on the good track in the future. So if you like, you can try out the pull request with JDK 17 and report back if you see any slowdowns or if it works, and also tell us if your Elasticsearch index needs less file handles or if you can open much larger indexes with many, many more chunks because of the change from 1 gigabyte to 16 gigabytes. So it would be good to get some feedback. And now I'm coming to the end of my talk. Sorry for being so fast, but I think we still have a few maybe 1 minute for
We're at minus 5 minutes, but there's a few minutes before the next talk. Uwe, thank you so much for this talk. I feel like there's so much content. This could be like a half day workshop or a 1 day workshop to, you know, have people poking around and figuring out how everything works.